Hello everyone, welcome to the Codex reading for Mass Effect. This is going to go up alongside the stream footage, probably at about the same time. People can skip them if they're uninterested or if they are already aware of them. I am not fully aware of everything that's in it, so a lot of this stuff is going to be new to me, but I will be commenting along the way as well. So let's go ahead and take a look. Once I've gotten through all of this, then any new stuff that pops up will be reviewed during the stream itself. Let's take.
The Asari were the first species to discover the Citadel.
Let's just jump right into it. Apparently,
when the Samaritans arrived, it was the Asari who proposed the establishment of the Citadel Council to maintain peace throughout the galaxy. Since then, the Asari have served as the mediators and centrists of the Council. An all-female race, the Asari reproduce through a form of parthenogenesis. They can attune.
Can they really be all female if they just have one gender?
Individual of any gender and of any species to reproduce. This capability has led to the unseemly and inaccurate rumors about Asari promiscuity. Asari can live for over 1,000 years, passing through 3 stages of life. In the maiden stage, they wander restlessly, seeking new knowledge and experience. When the matron stage begins, they meld with interesting partners to produce their offspring. This ends when they reach the matriarch stage, where they assume the roles of leaders and counselors.
AKA their space elves. Next up.
The second species to join the Citadel, the Solarians, are warm-blooded amphibians with a hyperactive metabolism. Solarians think fast, talk fast, and move fast. To Solarians, other species seem sluggish and dull-witted. Unfortunately, their metabolic speed leaves them with a relatively short lifespan. Solarians over the age of 40 are a rarity. The Solarians were responsible for advancing the development of the primitive Krogan species to use as soldiers during the Rachni Wars. They were also behind the creation of the genophage bioweapon the Turians used to quell the Krogan rebellion several centuries later. Solarians are known for their observational capability and non-linear thinking. This manifests as an aptitude for research and espionage. They are constantly experimenting and inventing, and it is generally accepted that they always know more than they are letting on.
An average lifespan of about 30, upper 30s to 40 is, that is really short. I mean, even if they think fast, still, that's not a whole lot of time to get stuff done and learn things, I would think. I don't know. It's not like we have any anything like that in our experience.
Roughly 1,200 years ago, the Turians were invited to join the Citadel Council to fulfill the role of galactic peacekeepers. The Turians have the largest fleet in Citadel space. They make up the single largest portion of the Council's military forces. As their territory and influence has spread, the Turians have come to rely on the Solarians for military intelligence and the Asari for diplomacy. Despite a somewhat colonial attitude towards the rest of the galaxy, the ruling hierarchy understands they would lose more than they would gain if the other two races were ever removed. Turians come from an autocratic society that values discipline and possesses a strong sense of personal and collective honor. There is lingering animosity between Turians and humans over the First Contact War of 2157, which is known as the Relay 314 incident to the Turians. Officially, however, the two species are allies, and they enjoy civil, if cool, diplomatic relations.
You know, one thing that I just noticed that they didn't mention, the Solarians, it says that they're amphibians. It doesn't say what the Asari and Turians are. Obviously, there's, scientifically speaking, it would be kind of difficult to strictly classify them as, well, mammals, amphibians, reptiles, whatever, simply because they wouldn't actually be those. They might be amphibian-like, mammal-like, reptile-like, something like that, but not exact. Yeah. I was actually kind of curious, because, you know, I mean, they talk about the Asari tentacle heads and stuff like that, but I don't think I've seen anything that actually says that they're cephalopod type, you know, descended from, like, cephalopods.
50,000 years ago, the Protheans were the only spacefaring species in the galaxy.
Maybe it says later
they
or something.
They vanished in a swift galactic extinction. Only the legacy of their empire remains. They are believed to have built the mass relays and the citadel, which have allowed numerous species to explore and expand throughout the galaxy. Prothean ruins are found on worlds across the galaxy. While surprisingly intact for their age, functioning examples of Prothean paleotechnology are rare. Time and generations of looters have picked their dead cities and derelict stations clean. Some believe the Protheans meddled in the evolution of younger races. The Hanar homeworld of Kaje, for example, shows clear evidence of former Prothean occupation. The presence of a former Prothean observation post on Mars has caused a rebirth of interventionary evolutionists among humans. These individuals believe the god myths of ancient civilizations are misremembered encounters with aliens.
So, this in particular for me, 50,000 years ago, Homo sapiens were functionally, biologically the same as they are today. Big societal differences, certainly, but, the Protheans would have needed to have meddled significantly earlier than, 50,000 years ago to really have a huge impact on humanity, I think. On top of that, at the time, there would have been multiple human species for them to meddle with. So they were probably just observing.
Though now extinct, the Rachni once threatened every species in Citadel space. Over 2,000 years ago, explorers foolishly opened a mass relay to a previously unknown system and encountered something never seen before or since, a species of spacefaring insects guided by a hive mind intelligence. Unfortunately, the Rachni were not peaceful, and the galaxy was plunged into a series of conflicts known as the Rachni Wars. Attempts to negotiate were futile, as it was impossible to make contact with the hive queens that guided the race from beneath the surface of their toxic home world. The emergence of the Krogan ended the Rachni Wars. Bred to survive the harshest environments, the Krogan were able to strike at the queens in their lairs and reclaim conquered council worlds. But when Krogan fleets pressed them back to their home world, the Rachni refused to surrender, and the Krogan eradicated them from the galaxy. In the early 2160s, the Alliance began aggressive colonization of worlds in the Skillian Verge, much to the dismay of the Batarians, who had been developing the region for several decades. In 2171, the Batarians petitioned the Council to declare the Verge a zone of Batarian interest. The Council refused, however, declaring unsettled worlds in the region open to human colonization. In protest, the Batarians closed their Citadel embassy and severed official diplomatic relations with the Council, effectively becoming a rogue state. They instigated a proxy war in the Verge by funneling money and weapons to criminal organizations, urging them to strike at human colonies. Hostilities peaked with the Skillian Blitz of 2176, an attack on the human capital of Elysium by Batarian-funded pirates and slavers. In 2178, the Alliance retaliated with a crushing assault on the moon of Torfin, long used as a staging base by Batarian-backed criminals. In the aftermath, the Batarians retreated into their own systems and are now rarely seen in Citadel space.
One thing that I'm not a big fan of is how monolithic so many of the species are. They're basically, like, all the same. Obviously, you know, in terms of a game, it'd be very difficult to make the wide variety of characters that you would see just among humans, for example, but still, it does tend to feel like every, you know, all, like, why aren't there Batarian traders coming to the Citadel? You know, I mean, if they're, as long as they have independent corporations and they're not all state-run, that should be a good trade route. Especially if, larger concerns aren't doing it.
The Elcor are a citadel species native to the high-gravity world Dakuna. They are massive creatures, standing on four muscular legs for increased stability. Elcor move slowly, an evolved response to an environment where a fall can be lethal. This has colored their psychology, making them deliberate and conservative. Elcor's speech is ponderous and monotone. Among themselves, scent, slight movements, and sub-vocalized infrasound convey shades of meaning that make a human smile seem as subtle as a fireworks display. Since their subtlety can lead to misunderstandings with other species, the Elcor often go out of their way to clarify when they are being sarcastic, amused, or angry. Dakuna's high gravity impedes mountain formation. Most of the world consists of flat, open plains, which prehistoric Elcor wandered across in small family bands. Modern Elcor still prefer open sky, and can become restless and uncomfortable on long starship journeys.
This is a bit about scent, slight movement, sub-vocalized infrasound, conveying shades of meaning. That's very much like the Sariels in the Forgotten Realms.
The Geth are a humanoid race of networked AIs. They were created by the Quarians 300 years ago as tools of labor and war. When the Geth showed signs of self-evolution, the Quarians attempted to exterminate them. The Geth won the resulting war. This example has led to legal, systematic repression of artificial intelligences in galactic society. The Geth possess a unique distributed intelligence. An individual has rudimentary animal instincts, but as their numbers and proximity increase, the apparent intelligence of each individual improves. In groups, they can reason, analyze situations, and use tactics as well as any organic race. Geth space is located at the trailing end of the Perseus Arm, beyond the lawless Terminus systems. The Perseus Veil, an obscuring dark nebula of opaque gas and dust, lies between their space and the Terminus systems.
So this seems to indicate that the creation of the Geth was what led to the laws against AI. But I'm pretty sure the discussion with Tali was that those laws already existed in the first place. Hoping we get some clarification on that.
The Hanar are a citadel species known for excessive politeness. They speak with scrupulous precision and take offense at improper language. Hanar that expect to deal with other species take special courses to help them unlearn their tendency to take offense at improper speech. All Hanar have two names. The face name is known to the world. The soul name is kept for use among close friends and relations. Hanar never refer to themselves in the first person in conversation with someone they know on a face-name basis. To do so is considered egotistical, so instead they refer to themselves as this one, or the impersonal it. Their homeworld, Kaje, has 90% ocean cover and orbits an energetic white star, resulting in a permanent blanket of cloud. Due to the presence of Prothean ruins on the world, many Hanar worship them, and Hanar myths often speak of an elder race that civilized them by teaching them language.
So again, I'm curious what they're actually supposed to be and how they're actually supposed to be floating. Sometimes it looks like they might be walking, but most of the time it looks like they're floating. I mean, obviously if they're filled with some sort of gas, but if they're filled with hydrogen, that would be dangerous. If they're filled with helium, how would they get that other than through an internal fusion process? I suppose they could be filled with one of the other lighter elements, but still, that's a good question.
When the Asari discovered the Citadel, they also discovered the Keepers, a docile, multi-limbed insect race that seemingly exists only to maintain and repair the Great Prothean Station. Early attempts to communicate with or study the Keepers were failures, and it is now illegal to interfere with or impede Keeper activity. Because they are completely non-threatening, keepers have become virtually invisible to everyone else. Similarly, they seem indifferent to other species, except for their tendency to help new arrivals integrate themselves into the Citadel. No matter how many keepers die due to old age, violence, or accident, they maintain a constant number. No one has discovered the source of new keepers, but some hypothesize they are genetic constructs. Biological androids created somewhere deep in the inaccessible core of the Citadel itself.
So I'm not the most fluent on science fiction stories, and especially the famous science fiction stories, but the situation with the Keepers and the Citadel strikes me as the exact same as the Spelljammer itself and the maintenance creatures on the Spelljammer, the Shivax. I'm not saying that the makers of this game drew from that, but the makers of this game drew from that.
The Krogan evolved in a hostile and vicious environment. Until the invention of gunpowder weapons, eaten by predators was still the number one cause of Krogan fatalities. Afterwards, it was death by gunshot. When the Salarians discovered them, the Krogan were a brutal, primitive species, struggling to survive a self-inflicted nuclear winter. The Salarians culturally uplifted them, teaching them to use and build modern technology, so they could serve as soldiers in the Rachni War. Liberated from the harsh conditions of their homeworld, the quick-breeding Krogan experienced an unprecedented population explosion. They began to colonize nearby worlds. Even though these worlds were already inhabited, the Krogan rebellions lasted nearly a century, only ending when the Turians unleashed the Genophage, a Salarian-developed bioweapon that crushed all Krogan resistance. The Genophage makes only 1 in 1,000 pregnancies viable, and today, the Krogan are a slowly dying breed. Understandably, the Krogan harbor a grudge against all other species, especially the Turians.
So it's not mentioned here, but I know elsewhere it's mentioned that they're pretty long-lived as well, something like 600 years. And given the now low birth rate, their basic and tendency for violence and stuff like that, they're space dwarves. Totally space dwarves.
Driven from their home system by the Geth nearly 3 centuries ago, most Quarians now live aboard the Migrant Fleet. A flotilla of 50,000 vessels ranging in size from passenger shuttles to mobile space stations. Home to 17 million Quarians, the flotilla understandably has scarce resources. Because of this, each Quarian must go on a rite of passage known as the pilgrimage when they come of age. They leave the fleet and only return once they have found something of value they can bring back to their people. Other species tend to look down on the Quarians for creating the Geth, and for the negative impact their fleet has when it enters a system. This has led to many myths and rumors about the Quarians, including the belief that underneath their clothes and breathing masks, they are actually cybernetic creatures, a combination of organic and synthetic parts.
I thought that they were known, what their appearance was already known, before they created the Geth and had to flee their homeworld. Obviously, on their homeworld, they wouldn't have needed this gear. Maybe they retconned a lot of this stuff later.
The Volus are a member species of the Citadel with their own embassy.
I mean, I've picked up some stuff over time.
Race of the Turians.
The years since this game came out,
they were voluntarily absorbed into the hierarchy, effectively trading their mercantile prowess for Turian military protection. Erun, their homeworld, lies far beyond the normal life zone of its star. However, the world has a high-pressure greenhouse atmosphere that traps enough heat to support an ammoni-based biochemistry. As a result, the Volus must wear pressure suits and breathers when dealing with other species, as conventional nitrogen-oxygen air mixtures are poisonous to them. And in the low-pressure atmospheres tolerable to most species, their flesh will actually split open. Volus culture is tribal, bartering lands and even people to gain status. This culture of exchange inclines them to economic pursuits. It was the Volus who authored the Unified Banking Act, and they continue to monitor and balance the Citadel economy.
Hmm. I was kind of hoping for a little bit more about what they look like under the suits as well.
After the Geth secure a location, they round up an impaled dead and living bodies on mechanical spikes. The spikes rapidly transform these victims into withered husks, extracting water and trace minerals, and replacing them with cybernetics. The cybernetics reanimate the lifeless flesh and tissue, transforming the bodies into mindless killing machines. Some Alliance soldiers refer to the husk-generating spikes as dragon's teeth, a reference to the mythological berserkers who sprang up from the earth wherever the teeth of the dragon Eris were planted. Dragon's teeth and husks bear little resemblance to other pieces of Geth technology. No one is sure why a synthetic race would bother to drain the minuscule amount of recoverable resources from organic corpses, though the value of reusing them as shock troops is obvious. The Citadel is an ancient deep space station, presumably constructed by the Protheans. Since the Prothean extinction, numerous species have come to call the Citadel home. It serves as the political, cultural, and financial capital of the galactic community. To represent their interests, most species maintain embassies on the Presidium, the Citadel's inner ring. The Citadel Tower, in the center of the Presidium, holds the Citadel Council Chambers. Council affairs often have far-reaching effects on the rest of the galactic community. Five arms, known as the Wards, extend from the Presidium. Their inner surfaces have been built into cities, populated by millions of inhabitants from across the galaxy. The Citadel is virtually indestructible. If attacked, the station can close its arms to form a solid, impregnable shell. For as long as the station has existed, an enigmatic race called the Keepers has maintained it.
If it closed the arms, wouldn't this still be accessible?
The Council is an executive committee composed of representatives from the Asari Republics, the Turian Hierarchy, and the Salarian Union. Though they have no official power over the independent governments of other species, the Council's decisions carry great weight throughout the galaxy. No single Council race is strong enough to defy the other two, and all have a vested interest in compromise and cooperation. Each of the Council species has general characteristics associated with the various aspects of governing the galaxy. The Asari are typically seen as diplomats and mediators. The Salarians gather intelligence and information. The Turians provide the bulk of the military and peacekeeping forces. Any species granted an embassy on the Citadel is considered an associate member, bound by the accords of the Citadel Conventions. Associate members may bring issues to the attention of the Council, though they have no input on the decision. The Human Systems Alliance became an associate member of the Citadel in 2165.
Having a council of just three, I mean, admittedly, they don't have direct power over their home races and everything like that, but still, I mean, obviously the influence would be pretty strong, and I assume that violating the decrees would possibly cause them to lose the seat on the council kind of thing, but still, only three people is, I'm not even sure what the proper term was, but that's not very much.
Citadel space is an unofficial term referring to any region of space controlled by a species that acknowledges the authority of the Citadel Council. At first glance, it appears this territory encompasses most of the galaxy. In reality, however, less than 1% of the stars have been explored. Even Mass Effect FTL Drive is slow relative to the volume of the galaxy. Empty space and systems without suitable drive discharge sites are barriers to exploration. Only the mass relays allow ships to jump hundreds of light years in an instant, the key to expanding across an otherwise impassable galaxy. Whenever a new relay is activated, the destination system is rapidly developed. From that hub, FTL Drive is used to expand to nearby star clusters. The result is a number of densely developed clusters, thinly spread across the vast expanse of space, connected by the mass relay network.
Okay, so that does explain a little bit to me about how sort of the borders and colonies are laid out in the galaxy.
Spectres are agents from the Office of Special Tactics and Reconnaissance, and answer only to the Citadel Council. They are elite military operatives, granted the authority to deal with threats to peace and stability in whatever way they deem necessary. They operate independently or in groups of two or three. Some are empathetic peacekeepers, resolving disputes through diplomacy. Others are cold-blooded assassins, ruthlessly dispatching problem individuals. All get the job done one way or another, often operating outside the bounds of galactic law. The Spectres were founded after the Salarians joined the Council. For many years, they operated in secrecy as backroom problem solvers. Only after the Krogan rebellions did their activities become publicized. Assignment of a Spectre is less contentious than a military deployment, but makes it clear that the Council is concerned about a situation.
I'm sure I'll have some more to say about Spectres as we go.
Humanity's first contact with an alien race occurred in 2157. At that time, the Alliance allowed survey fleets to activate any dormant mass relays discovered, a practice considered dangerous and irresponsible by Council-aligned races. When a Turian patrol discovered a human fleet attempting to activate a relay, they attacked. One human vessel survived, retreating to the colony of Shanxi. The Turians followed, quickly defeating the local forces. Shanxi was occupied, the first and to date only human world to be conquered by an alien species. The Turians believed the handful of ships they defeated represented the bulk of human defenses, so they were unprepared when the second fleet, under Admiral Castany Drescher, launched a strong counter-offensive, evicting them from Shanxi. The Turians mobilized for full-scale war, drawing the attention of the rest of the galaxy. The Council quickly intervened, forcing a truce. Fortunately for humanity, the First Contact War was ended with a diplomatic solution.
I mean, I can see why the Council races would see activating mass relays a bad practice, considering the Rachni Wars. But you can't exactly fault someone who's never encountered the rest, you know, any of the rest of the species before in the galaxy before for doing that. You want to explore, you know? I mean, to be perfectly honest, the Turians for attacking first rather than just saying, whoa there, let's hold on here, kind of thing. That's pretty aggressive.
The Systems Alliance is an independent supranational government representing the interests of humanity as a whole. The Alliance is responsible for the governance and defense of all extrasolar colonies and stations. The Alliance grew out of the various national space programs as a matter of practicality. Sol's planets had been explored and exploited through piecemeal national efforts. The expense of colonizing entire new solar systems could not be met by any one country. With humans knowing that alien contact was inevitable, there was enough political will to jointly fund an international effort. Still, the Alliance was often disregarded by those on Earth until the First Contact War. While the national governments dithered and bickered over who should lead the effort to liberate Shanxi, the Alliance fleet struck decisively. Post-war public approval gave the Alliance the credibility to establish its own parliament and become the galactic face of humanity.
I wonder how and why the Alliance had a powerful fleet in the first place if we hadn't encountered anyone, and how the rest of the nations of Earth actually let that happen. I mean, that would have been a threat to all the nations on Earth. The Alliance could have turned around and attacked them all, you know, if it was taken over by someone who wanted to do that.
Pharos is a habitable world in the Attican Beta Cluster. Two-thirds of the habitable surface is covered with the ruins of a crumbling Prothean megatropolis. In the millennia since the Prothean extinction, the ruins have been repeatedly picked over by looters many times. Pharos was considered a poor prospect for colonization, as little open ground remains for agriculture. The only sizable freshwater sources are the poles, which are tapped by the decaying Prothean aqueduct systems. The dead cities, while in good condition considering their antiquity, are of uncertain stability. Ground level is congested by a dozen meters of fallen debris, and the air is fouled by dust. In 2178, the Human Exogeny Corporation announced its intention to place a permanent colony on Pharos to thoroughly explore the ruins. The pioneer settlement was placed on the upper levels of several intact skyscrapers, using the surviving Prothean aqueducts and rooftop hydroponic gardens to support the population.
That is some impressive construction, if that much is left. I mean, take a look at pictures from Chernobyl, which has been, you know, completely abandoned for decades, and stuff is already getting, falling apart and getting covered in plant matter and stuff like that. It does not take long for nature to reclaim inhabited lands when people leave.
Novaria is a cool, rocky world with most of its hydrosphere locked up in massive glaciers. A privately chartered colony world, the planet is owned by the Novaria Development Corporation Holding Company. The NDC is funded by investment capital from 24 high-technology development firms and administrated by an executive board representing their interests. The investors built remote hot labs in isolated locations across Novaria's surface. These facilities are used for research too dangerous or controversial to be performed elsewhere, as Novaria is technically not part of Citadel space and therefore exempt from Council law. By special arrangement, Citadel's special tactics and reconnaissance agents have been granted extraterritorial privileges, but it remains to be seen how committed the executive board is to that principle. Given its unique situation, it is understandable that Novaria is often implicated in all manner of wild conspiracy theories.
Hey, it's what space Silicon Valley would be.
The Terminus systems are located on the far side of the Attican Traverse, beyond the space administered by the Citadel Council or claimed by the Human Systems Alliance. It is populated by a loose affiliation of minor species. United only in their refusal to acknowledge the political authority of the Council, or adhere to the Citadel conventions. Their independence comes at a price. The Terminus is fraught with conflict. War among the various species is common, as governments and dictators constantly rise and fall. The region is a haven for illegal activities, particularly piracy and the slave trade. At least once a year, a fleet from the Terminus invades the nearby Attican Traverse. These attacks are typically small raids against poorly defended colonies. The Council rarely retaliates, as sending patrols into the Terminus systems could unify the disparate species against their common foe, triggering a long and costly war.
Well, you know, or if you targeted the attack to just the people who attacked you, I would think most of the rest would just kind of stand back and say, hey, if we weren't involved.
There are between 200 and 400 billion stars in the galaxy, and less than 1% of them have ever been visited or had their systems properly surveyed. Humanity's early expansion into the Attican Traverse was haphazard, a desperate race to claim habitable planets where populations can be economically settled. Ignored in the wake of this land grab were thousands of less hospitable worlds, each potentially rich with industrial resources. The wealth of entire solar systems lies untapped, waiting for corporate survey teams or independent pioneers to discover and exploit them. However, this is not an easy task. In addition to the environmental hazards, the fact that uncharted worlds are largely ignored makes them popular bases for criminals, revolutionaries, cults, and others who wish to remain unnoticed by galactic society.
In other words, in this game, as you explore these uncharted worlds, you'll be encountering all of those things.
Faster-than-light drives use element zero cores to reduce the mass of the ship, allowing higher rates of acceleration. This effectively raises the speed of light within the mass effect field, allowing high-speed travel with negligible relativistic time dilation effects. Starships still require conventional thrusters, chemical rockets, commercial fusion torch, economy ion engine, or military anti-proton drive, in addition to the FTL drive core. With only a core, a ship has no motive power. The amount of ESO and power required for a drive increases exponentially to the mass being moved and the degree it is being lightened. Very massive ships, or very high speeds, are prohibitively expensive. If the field collapses while the ship is moving at faster than light speed, the effects are catastrophic. The ship is snapped back to sublight velocity, the enormous excess energy shed in the form of lethal Cherenkov radiation.
What, not Minovsky particles?
Larger warships are generally classified in one of four weights. Frigates are small, fast ships used for scouting and screening of larger vessels. Frigates often operate in wolfpack flotillas. Cruisers are middleweight combatants, faster than dreadnoughts and more heavily armed than frigates. Cruisers are the standard patrol unit and often lead frigate flotillas. Dreadnoughts are kilometer-long capital ships mounting heavy, long-range firepower. They are only deployed for the most vital missions. Carriers are dreadnought-sized vessels that also carry large numbers of fighters. Smaller vessels are almost exclusively used in a support role to the warships during combat. Fighters are one-man craft used to perform close-range attacks on enemy ships. Interceptors are one-man craft optimized for destroying opposing fighters. The Normandy is a prototype starship developed by the Human Systems Alliance with the assistance of the Citadel Council. It is optimized for scouting and reconnaissance missions in unstable regions using state-of-the-art stealth technology. For most ships, the heat generated through standard operations is easily detectable against the absolute zero background of space. The Normandy, however, is able to temporarily sink this heat within the hull. Combined with refrigeration of the exterior hull, the ship can travel undetected for hours or drift passively for days of covert observation. This is not without risk. The stored heat must eventually be radiated, or it will build to levels capable of cooking the crew alive. Another component of the stealth system is the Normandy's revolutionary Tantalus drive, a mass effect core twice the standard size. The Tantalus drive generates mass concentrations that the Normandy falls into, allowing it to move without the use of heat-emitting thrusters.
Interesting about the absolute zero background of space, considering that heat as an energy is related to molecules moving. With no molecules, you really have no actual temperature. Space can actually be very, very hot, and you just wouldn't know it because there are no molecules hitting you.
The Mako infantry fighting vehicle was designed for the System Alliance's frigates. Though the interior is cramped, an M35 is small enough to be carried in the cargo bay and easily deployed on virtually any world.
I.e. dropped from great heights.
With its turreted 155mm mass accelerator and coaxially mounted machine gun, the Mako can provide a fire team with weapons support as well as mobility. Since Alliance Marines may be required to fight on any world, the Mako is environmentally sealed and equipped with microthrusters for use on low-gravity planetoids. The Mako is powered by a sealed hydrogen-oxygen fuel cell and includes a small element zero core. While not large enough to nullify the vehicle's mass, the core can reduce it enough to be safely airdropped. When used in conjunction with thrusters, it also allows the Mako to extricate itself from difficult terrain.
Don't believe the lies. Don't believe the lies. Also, this is mostly just the excuse for why... It never actually rolls over and stuff like that.
Biotics is the ability of rare individuals to manipulate dark energy and create mass effect fields through the use of electrical impulses from the brain. Intense training and surgically implanted amplifiers are necessary for a biotic to produce mass effect fields powerful enough for practical use. The relative strength of biotic abilities varies greatly among species and with each individual. There are three branches of biotics. Telekinesis uses mass-lowering fields to levitate or impel objects. Mass-raising kinetic fields are used to block or pin objects. Spatial distortion uses rapidly shifting mass fields to shred objects. Most organic species are capable of developing biotic abilities, though there are risks involved. Biotics are the result of an in utero exposure to element zero. This usually causes fatal cancers in the victim, but in rare cases, it coalesces into nodules within the fetus's developing nervous system.
Aren't like the Asari all capable of using biotics? Maybe it's just the ones that you mostly see.
An artificial intelligence is a self-aware computing system capable of learning and independent decision-making. Creation of a conscious AI requires adaptive code, a slow, expensive education, and a specialized quantum computer called a blue box. An AI cannot be transmitted across a communication channel or computer network. Without its blue box, an AI is no more than data files. Loading these files into a new blue box will create a new personality, as variations in the quantum hardware and runtime results create unpredictable variations. The Geth serve as a cautionary tale against the dangers of rogue AI, and in Citadel space, they are technically illegal. Advocacy groups argue, however, that an AI is a living, conscious entity, deserving the same rights as organics. They argue that continued use of the term artificial is institutionalized racism on the part of organic life. The term synthetic is considered the politically correct alternative.
I can't disagree with that.
A virtual intelligence is an advanced form of user interface software. VIs use a variety of methods to simulate natural conversation, including an audio interface and an avatar personality to interact with. Although a VI can provide a convincing emulation of sentience, they are not self-aware, nor can they learn or take independent action. VIs are used as operating systems on commercial and home computers. Minimal VI agents are also available. Agents are compact and specialized. Some serve as personal secretaries, filtering calls and scheduling meetings based on user-defined priorities. Others are advanced search engines, propagating themselves across the extranet to collate user-requested data. Commercial VIs in a variety of stock personalities are available at any software retailer. Boutique firms and hobbyists also build unique VIs to personal specification. Although software emulation of living personalities is illegal, reconstructions of famous historical figures are common. When subjected to an electrical current, the rare material dubbed Element Zero, or EZO, emits a dark energy field that raises or lowers the mass of all objects within it. This mass effect is used in countless ways, from generating artificial gravity to manufacturing high-strength construction materials. It is most prominently used to enable faster-than-light space travel. EZO is generated when solid matter, such as a planet, is affected by the energy of a star going supernova. The material is common in the asteroid debris that orbits neutron stars and pulsars. These are dangerous places to mine, requiring extensive use of robotics, telepresence, and shielding to survive the incredible radiation from the dead star. Only a few major corporations can afford the setup costs required to work these primary sources. Humanity discovered refined Element Zero at the Prothean Research Station on Mars, allowing them to create mass effect fields and develop FTL travel.
I was wondering a little bit about that. I believe there's a mass relay in the Sol system, but I wasn't sure if that was discovered on Mars or in our solar system, or if it was brought there after the fact. Sounds like it was probably brought there after the fact.
Element zero can increase or decrease the mass of a volume of space-time when subjected to an electrical current. With a positive current, mass is increased. With a negative current, mass is decreased. The stronger the current, the greater the magnitude of the dark energy mass effect. In space, low mass fields allow FTL travel and inexpensive surface-to-orbit transit. High mass fields create artificial gravity and push space debris away from vessels. In manufacturing, low mass fields permit the creation of evenly blended alloys, while high mass compaction creates dense, sturdy construction materials. The military makes extensive use of mobility-enhancing technologies, with mass effect utilizing fighting vehicles standard frontline issue in most military forces. Mass effect fields are also essential in the creation of kinetic barriers or shields to protect against enemy fire.
Yeah, they're Banofsky particles.
Mass relays are feats of Prothean engineering advanced far beyond the technology of any living species. They are enormous structures scattered throughout the stars and can create corridors of virtually mass-free space, allowing instantaneous transit between locations separated by years or even centuries of travel using conventional FTL drives. Primary mass relays can propel ships thousands of light years, often from one spiral arm of the galaxy to another. However, they have fixed one-to-one connections. A primary relay connects to one other primary relay and nowhere else. Secondary relays can only propel ships across a few hundred light years. However, they are omnidirectional. A secondary relay can send a ship to any other relay within its limited range. There are many dormant primary relays whose corresponding twins have not yet been located. These are left inactive until their partner is charted, as established civilizations are unwilling to blindly open a passage that might connect them to a hostile species.
So number one, unless they're marked with, like, you know, A, and you find the other one marked A, how do you know, you know, when you found a second one without activating it? Number two, just because you haven't activated this one doesn't mean that someone on the other end isn't going to activate it and come to you, and then decide to kill you all.
Omni-tools are handheld devices that combine a computer microframe, sensor analysis pack, and manufacturing fabricator. Versatile and reliable, an Omni-tool can be used to analyze and adjust the functionality of most standard equipment, including weapons and armor, from a distance. The fabrication module can rapidly assemble small, three-dimensional objects from common, reusable industrial plastics, ceramics, and light alloys. This allows for field repairs and modifications to most standard items, as well as the reuse of salvaged equipment. Omni-tools are standard issue for soldiers and first-in colonists.
It's pretty handy. It does everything. Alright, on to the secondary ones, which I believe I have to read all myself. There's player tutorials. Not going to actually read through those. Personal history summary. You were born on Earth, but you never knew your parents. Child of the streets, you learned to live by your wits and guts, surviving in the hidden underbelly of the megatropolises of humanity's homeworld. Eager to find a better life, you joined the Alliance military when you came of age. You were on shore leave at Elysium when the first wave of the Skillian Blitz struck. A massive coalition force of slavers, crime syndicates, and Batarian warlords attacked the human colony, determined to wipe it out. You rallied the civilian inhabitants, leading them in their desperate fight to hold off the invaders. When enemy troops broke through the colony's defenses, you single-handedly held them off and sealed the breach. After hours of brutal fighting, reinforcements finally arrived, and the enemy broke ranks and fled. Because of your actions, Elysium was saved, and you are regarded throughout the Alliance as a true hero. Well, you know, I mean, it makes sense, being the Avatar of the Virtues and everything like that. Aliens, Council Races, Turians, Unification War. At about the time the Salarians and Asari were forming the Council, the Turians were embroiled in a bitter civil war. The Unification War, as it was later named, began with hostilities between the colonies furthest from the Turian homeworld, Palavin. These colonies were run by local chieftains, many of whom had distanced themselves from the hierarchy. Without the galvanizing influence of the government, the colonies became increasingly isolated and xenophobic. Colonists began wearing emblems or facial markings to differentiate themselves from members of other colonies, and open hostilities became common. Or are these the emblems that we found? When the war finally broke out, the hierarchy maintained strict diplomacy and refused to get involved. After several years of fighting, less than a dozen factions remained, and the hierarchy finally intervened. By that time, the chieftains were too weak to resist. They were forced to put an end to fighting and renew their allegiance to the hierarchy. Though peace was restored, it took several decades for animosity between the colonists to fade completely. To this day, most Turians still wear the facial markings of their home colonies. As a point of interest, the Turian term barefaced refers to one who is beguiling or not to be trusted. Or not be trusted, huh? It is also a slang term for politicians. Aliens, extinct races, Protheans, data disks. Despite all evidence confirming the existence of the Protheans, little is known about their culture and society. From time to time, dig sites will yield nude clues, but after 50,000 years of decay, little of value is unearthed. It amazes me that some of this stuff actually still works, like the beacon. That is some impressive anti-entropy technology there. Recent research has focused on the discovery of Prothean data disks. Part of it is because, like, you get microcrystallization on, not just wiring, but on chips and, you know, microchips and circuit boards. It's very easy for, basically, crystals of metal to form between the circuits on a circuit board and short it all out. There's some thought that some of our, you know, distant satellites, like, which one was one that, failed kind of, sort of recently that had been out there for a while? I can't remember, but, there's a lot of thought that that's what causes a lot of those to fail. Let's see. Recent research has focused on the discovery of Prothean data disks. On their own, they are frail and rarely found in one piece. Occasionally, however, an intact disk will be discovered within a console or reading device. To date, over 36 disks have been recovered, and a few of those have been restored to the point where researchers can begin analyzing them. Though it may be some time before scientists discover a way to transfer the data off the disks, they are currently considered the most tangible leads for learning more about Prothean culture. Aliens, non-council races, Krogan, Genophage. The Genophage bioweapon was created to end the Krogan rebellions. From the start, the Krogan had overwhelmed the council. Only timely first contact with the Turians saved the council races. The Turians fought the Krogan to a standstill, but sheer weight of Krogan numbers indicated the war could not be won through conventional means. The Turians collaborated with the Salarians to genetically engineer a counter to the rapid breeding of the Krogan. The Genophage virus gained the energy to replicate by eating key genetic sequences. Every cell in every Krogan had to be altered for the weapon to be foolproof. Otherwise, the Krogan could have used gene therapy to fix the affected tissue. Once a Genophage strain could find no more genes to eat, it would starve and die, limiting spin-off mutation and contamination. This created genetic flaw is hereditary. The Salarians believed the Genophage would be used as a deterrent, a position the Turians viewed as naive. Once the project was complete, the Turians mass-produced and deployed it. The Krogan homeworld, their colonies, and all occupied worlds were infected. The resulting mutation made only 1 in 1,000 Krogan pregnancies carry to term. It did not reduce fertility, but offspring viability. The rare females able to carry children to term became prizes the Krogan warlords fought brutal battles over. The Krogan are a shadow of their former glory. While the rebellions took place centuries ago, they are constantly reminded of the horror of the Genophage and their inability to counter it. The release of the Genophage is still controversial, bitterly debated in many circles. It is pretty bad. I mean, not reducing fertility, but offspring viability is pretty horrible. It would be much, much better to just prevent most pregnancies from not taking. You know, the embryos to not implant kind of thing. Then again, you could probably then do in vitro fertilization, stuff like that, and raise them that way. With offspring viability being affected, you can't do that. But still, it's pretty horrible. And certainly in vitro fertilization, I mean, like, a fully in vitro race would be, incredibly, incredibly expensive. Krogan Rebellions. After the Rachni War, the quick-breeding Krogan expanded at the expense of their neighbors. Warlords leveraged their veteran soldiers to seize living space while the council races were still grateful. Over centuries, the Krogan conquered world after world. There was always just one more needed. When the council finally demanded withdrawal from the Asari colony of Lucia, Krogan overlord Kredak stormed off the citadel, daring the council to take the worlds back. But the council had taken precautions. The finest STG operators and Asari huntresses had been drafted into a covert observation force, the Office of Special Tactics and Reconnaissance. The Spectres opened the war with crippling strategic strikes. Krogan planets went dark as computer viruses flooded the extranet. Sabotage to antimatter refineries disappeared in blue-white annihilation. Headquarters stations shattered into orbit-clogging debris, rammed by pre-placed suicide freighters. Still, this only delayed the inevitable. The war would have been lost if not for the first contact with the Turians, who responded to Krogan threats with a prompt declaration of war. Being on the far side of Krogan space from the Council, the Turians advanced rapidly into the lightly defended Krogan rear areas. The Krogan responded by dropping space stations and asteroids on Turian colonies. Oh hey, colony drops, always fun. Three worlds were rendered completely uninhabitable. This was precisely the wrong approach to take with the Turians. Each is first and foremost a public servant, willing to risk his life to protect his comrades. Rather than increasing public war weariness, Krogan tactics stiffened Turian resolve. The arrival of Turian task forces saved many worlds from the Warlord's marauding fleets, but it took development of the genophage bioweapon to end the war. There were decades of unrest afterwards. Rogue warlords and holdout groups of insurgents refused to surrender or disappeared into the frontier systems to become pirates. Quarian's economy. The migrant fleet has little economic base, operating in a state of perpetual hand-to-mouth. While Quarian ships include light manufacturing and assembly plants, they lack heavy industries such as refining and shipbuilding. The fleet has tankers for water purification and oxygen cracking, but the space-intensive nature of agriculture limits food production. A single disaster could destroy the fragile balance. The Quarians earn income in creative ways. Because the government is obliged to provide food, water, air, and medical support for every individual, the Conclave strategically determines the course of the fleet to bring in resources and income. A species who suspects the migrant fleet is heading towards their space often offers a gift of surplus starships, fuel, and resources to convince the Conclave to alter course. As the fleet passes through a system, swarms of mining vessels work over asteroids for metals and Silicious materials. That would be silicon. Not sure if I've seen that adjectival form before. And cometary bodies for water ice and organics. Quarian miners are adept at locating and strip mining spaceborne resources. This sparks conflict with corporations already working the system. Large mining concerns spend millions on lobbyists and public relations, portraying the Quarians as locusts, devouring the resources of a system before moving on. The greatest asset of the Quarians is their rarefied skills. Now, I do want to point out that 17 million people would really not be able to work over a whole system. They might be able to take the really, like, the cream of the crop, easiest to get stuff. Certainly a lot of comets and stuff like that, and smaller, asteroids and stuff like that. But a place like Ceres, which is a dwarf planetoid in and of itself, there's no way that they'd be able to take much out of that. And they wouldn't have a need for it. There's only 17 million of them. I mean, that's a lot, but we're talking smaller population than greater New York City. The greatest asset of the Quarians is their rarefied skills. Most are experienced miners. Due to their life of perpetual salvage and repair, they are skilled engineers and technicians. More than once, the very corporations that lobby against the Quarians have made backroom deals with the fleet, arranging for skilled Quarians to fill space engineering jobs that other species would demand higher wages for. Quarians are widely hated among the working classes. "The Quarians are coming to take our jobs" is a common response to the fleet's approach. Well, yeah, that's basically just a not all that subtle reference to Europe's, or many portions of Europe's views on Muslims. But the thing is, 17 million. Set up some goddamn Island 3 colonies for them someplace. You know, I mean, there is no way that they would take an entire... You could give them a solar system somewhere. There's 17 million of them. They would have more than enough resources in the solar system to utilize for a long, long time. Just build some space colonies somewhere for them. Quarian's government. Due to the Quarian's precarious existence and the need to enforce strict rationing, government is somewhat autocratic. The migrant fleet's operations are directed by the Admiralty, a board of five military officers who are advised by a legislative body called the Conclave. Each vessel in the fleet has the right to send representatives to the Conclave aboard the flagship. The number of representatives is based on the crew size. Larger clans with bigger ships and more votes form the cores of political blocks. Opposition comes from the Outriders Coalition, with delegates from thousands of smaller ships. The Admiralty defers to the Conclave's decisions in most circumstances. However, if all five members agree that a Conclave decision jeopardizes the survival of the fleet and cannot get the Conclave to address their concerns, they have the right to summarily overturn the legislative decision. After the Admiralty uses this extraordinary power, they must resign. If the Admiralty does not step down after using their veto, the rest of the military is obliged to arrest them. Of course, you know, they could all just choose not to do that, and then there would be chaos. Each ship captain has authority over his vessel, but is advised by an elected civilian council, just as the Admiralty is advised by the Conclave. This relationship may range from cooperation to polite tolerance to outright hostility. But any captain who overrules his council without good reason is relieved of command by the Admiralty. Many Quarian ships are owned by clans who pool their resources to purchase used vessels from private sellers. Large ships are prestigious for big, rich clans, but a small ship means status for a small clan with enough personal wealth to afford a private vessel. Clan vessel captains are not subject to dismissal by the Admiralty. Abusive captains are a family problem if they do not disrupt the operations of the fleet. Quarian's Migrant Fleet. The Migrant Fleet is the largest concentration of space starfaring vessels in the galaxy, sprawling across millions of kilometers. It can take days for the entire fleet to pass through a mass relay. When the Quarians fled their homeworld, the fleet was a motley aggregation of freighters, shuttles, industrial vessels, and the odd warship. After 3 centuries, all have been modified to support larger crews as comfortably as possible. As the Quarians achieved stability, they began weeding out the ships least suitable for long-term habitation, selling them and pooling the money to buy larger and more spaceworthy hulls. This process is ongoing as vessels wear out and break down. While some ships enjoy dedicated cabins with full privacy and sanitary facilities, many more are former freighters, whose cargo bays and containers are pressurized and divided into family spaces using simple metal cubicle bulkheads. The Quarians enliven these austere spaces with colorful quilts and tapestries, which also help muffle sound. The day-to-day operations of the fleet, traffic control, station keeping, supply distribution, and so on, are under military jurisdiction. Though ship captains have the authority to deviate from their assigned positions and may leave the fleet at any time, they are assumed to do so at their own risk. As the migrant fleet moves around the galaxy, many ships split off to pursue individual goals, returning days or years later. Quarian's Pilgrimage. When Quarians of the Migrant Fleet reach young adulthood, they must leave their birth ship and find a new crew to accept them as permanent residents. To prove themselves, they must recover something of value. This is offered to their prospective captain as proof they will not be a mere burden on the shoestring resources of the ship. The process is called the Pilgrimage. Stripped of ritual, the Pilgrimage is merely an attempt to maintain genetic diversity within the small, relatively isolated population bases that make up the Migrant Fleet. If the young stayed and married within their birth vessel, the risk of inbreeding would increase sharply. Quarians are surgically fitted with their various immunity-boosting implants in preparation for leaving on pilgrimage. Having grown up within the sterile, controlled environments of the Migrant Fleet ships, Quarians have virtually no natural immune system. I don't know, that's a bit of a stretch. I mean, having a reduced immune system, sure, but virtually no natural immune system? Citadel and Galactic Government. Citadel Conventions. These diplomatic talks occurred in the wake of the Krogan Rebellions as a response to the destruction of the conflict and an attempt to distance the Council from the brutal Krogan warfare. The conventions regulate the use of weapons of mass destruction. A WMD causes environmental alteration to a world. A bomb that produces a large crater is not considered a WMD. A bomb that causes a nuclear winter is. What if it takes many, 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 many bombs to cause a nuclear winter? Use of WMD is forbidden on garden worlds like Earth, with ecospheres that can readily support a population. If a habitable world is destroyed, it will not be replaced for millions of years. The conventions do not forbid the use of a WMD on hostile worlds or in sealed space station environments. Oh, well, that's just lovely. Many militaries continue to develop and maintain stockpiles. The conventions graded weapons of mass destruction into tiers of concern. Tier 1 is the greatest threat to galactic peace. Tier 1, large kinetic impactors, such as asteroid drops or deorbiting space stations. Effectively free and available in any system in the form of debris left over from planetary accretion, kinetic impactors are the weapon of choice for terrorists and third galaxy nations. Tier 2, uncontrolled self-replicating weapons such as nanotechnology, viral or bacteriological organisms, von Neumann devices, and destructive computer viruses. These weapons can... destructive computer viruses? I could see how that would cause damage to a population, but... I mean, other than taking control of things to cause environmental harm, but that would still be just a specific type of destructive computer viruses. These weapons can lie dormant for millennia, waiting for a careless visitor to carry them onto another world. Tier 3, large energy burst weapons, such as nuclear or antimatter warheads. Tier 4, alien species deliberately introduced to crowd out native forms necessary for the health of an ecosystem. Ecological tampering can take years to bear fruit, making it difficult to prove. Citadel Station, Citadel Security Services, CSEC. Citadel Security is a volunteer police force answering to the Citadel Council. The 200,000 constables of CSEC are responsible for maintaining the public order in the densely populated Citadel. They also provide pirate suppression, customs enforcement, and search and rescue throughout the Citadel cluster. CSEC has 6 divisions. Enforcement, uniformed officers who patrol the Citadel and respond to emergencies. Investigation, detectives who puzzle out the truth behind crimes and bring perpetrators to justice. Customs, screens the thousands of passengers and cargo containers that pass through the Citadel's ports every day. Network, deals with cybercrimes like identity and copyright theft, hacking and viral attacks, and illegal artificial intelligence. Special Response, deals with hostage situations, bombs, and heavily armed criminals. In the unlikely event that attackers board the Citadel, they are also the front line of defense, armed with military-grade equipment. Patrol, naval arm with ships stationed throughout the Citadel cluster. Unlike the other divisions, they are rarely seen at the Citadel, nor do they stay in one place long. Joining CSEC is prestigious. Applications must be sponsored by a Citadel counselor or the ambassador of an associate council race. Generally, applicants have many years of distinguished service in the military or police forces of their nation, but an inexperienced applicant with demonstrable talent will be fairly considered. CSEC and the Spectres are often at odds. Many CSEC members, notably current executor Venari Palin, believe that allowing Spectres to be above the law is a dangerous practice, and the actions of Saren Artarius lend credence to this position. The Spectres, in turn, are aggravated when CSEC's dedication to procedure and due process hampers their investigations. I am kind of on CSEC's side there. Citadel Station, Presidium Ring. The ring is an enclosed loop of park-like space serving as the connection point for the wards. The interior walls are lined with the embassies of influential species and private residences for the galaxy's elite. The Presidium is full of open-air restaurants, bars, and luxurious meeting areas. Gravity is about one-third Earth normal. A holographic sky is projected over the ceiling of the ring. Unlike the 24/7 bustle of the wards, the Presidium maintains a 20-hour day schedule with a six-hour night, where lights are dimmed and the sky goes through a night cycle. Offices and residences are often open to the interior. It is not unusual for embassies to have no exterior wall at all. This does not cause a crime problem due to the heavy CSEC presence and ubiquitous monitoring devices on the Presidium. Thieves are quickly identified and apprehended. The ring is the location of the Citadel's spaceports. Being closer to the center of the spin, there is less motion for a ship to match, and the reduced spin gravity makes handling cargo easier. Hundreds of ships pass through the Citadel every day, and every species with an embassy is granted a private dock. The tower, at the center of the ring, holds the administration of the Citadel Council. The tower rises over a kilometer from the ring, appearing to thrust toward forward parallel to the ward arms. As the tower is at the center of the spin axis, it experiences little centrifugal force. Gravity is maintained using mass effect fields at a 90-degree angle to the ring and wards. A consular dock can be found at the base of the tower. While normally used for diplomatic couriers and Spectre business, the shuttles docked here can evacuate the Council government in an emergency. Citadel Station, Serpent Nebula. The Citadel is surrounded by a blue-tinted reflection nebula. The light of the nebula is actually light from the Citadel, scattered and reflected back at the station. At first, the Serpent Nebula was assumed to be made of microscopic construction debris. Prevailing theory holds that the Protheans used a molecular nanotechnology to manufacture the incredibly durable materials used in the Citadel. But unlike other nebulae, the Serpent does not dissipate over time, therefore it must be replenished constantly. The current popular theory is that non-recyclable waste collected by the Citadel's keepers is somehow rendered down to the atomic or molecular level and ejected into the cloud. The thick nebula presents a navigation hazard. Beyond the relatively clear areas around the Citadel, electrical discharges are common. These are not blocked by kinetic barriers and can severely damage metal-framed starships. In addition, some dense knots of dust can overwhelm the repulsion kinetic barriers on smaller ships. If such a vessel is moving fast enough at the time, the effects are similar to being hit by a sandblaster. Attempting to reach the Citadel through open space navigation is unadvisable. The only safe approach is through the various mass relays that orbit it.
So then how did they discover this if the current species don't use mass relays that they don't know the destination from?
Citadel Station statistics. Although the Citadel is equipped with mass effect generating element zero cores, most of the gravity on the station is generated by the centrifugal force of rotation. Rotation 3.5 minutes per rotation. Rotational gravity in the wards, 1.02 Earth. Rotational gravity in the Presidium, 0.3 Earth. Total length open, 44.7 kilometers. Diameter open, 12.8 kilometers. Ward length, 43.6 kilometers. Ward width, 330 meters.
Wow, really?
It's not very wide. Presidium ring diameter, 7.2 kilometers. Presidium ring width, 553 meters. Exterior arm thickness, 13 meters. That is really not very much. Population, 13.2 million, not including keepers. Gross weight, 7.11 billion metric tons. And height of the Presidium tower, 1,047 meters. Citadel Station wards. The majority of the Citadel's population lives in the wards, the five massive arms of the station that house the residential and commercial districts. Many galactic races have established cultural enclaves here. Population density and cost of living are extremely high, akin to Earth cities such as Hong Kong and Singapore. The wards are open-topped, with skyscrapers rising from the superstructure. Towers are sealed against vacuum, as the breathable atmosphere envelope is only maintained at a height of about 7 meters. The atmosphere is contained by the centrifugal force of rotation and a membrane of dense colorless sulfur hexafluoride gas held in place by carefully managed mass effect fields. The view from the wards is spectacular. In the background, stars, Serpent Nebula, and the nearby blue giant called the Widow move across the sky as the station rotates to stabilize itself. In the foreground, the lights of buildings and vehicles in the opposing ward arms perpetually shine. The Citadel has no real day or night. While the station keeps to standard galactic time for political functions, which I assume is 24 hours, just coincidentally Earth normal time. While the station keeps to the standard galactic time for political functions, businesses rarely close, and residents acclimate to sleep and work according to personal need rather than a day-night cycle. Additions and modifications are constantly being constructed, though they must stay within certain specifications that will not compromise the operation of the station. Occasionally, the keepers will descend on an area of the wards and move or change the architecture without explanation. Residents have learned to live with these inexplicable intrusions. Treaty of Ferrixen. Due to the destructive potential of dreadnoughts, the Council races agreed that at the Ferrixen Naval Conference to fix a ratio of dreadnought construction between themselves. At the top of the pyramid is the peacekeeping Turian fleet. Below the Turians are the other Council races, currently the Asari and Salarians. Council associate races are at the bottom. The Human Systems Alliance is part of this last group. The ratio of Turian to Council to associate dreadnoughts is 5-3-1. For every dreadnought humans are permitted to build, the Asari have 3 and the Turians 5. What if they don't want to build more? I mean, what's the enforcement mechanism on that? Other than the treaty. Humanity and the Systems Alliance. Human diplomatic relations. Humanity has encountered many galactic species. Wars have been few, but mistrust is rife. Politically, the Alliance is a peaceful trade partner of the Turians. As a practical matter, however, there is simmering antagonism and bigotry between both populations over the First Contact War of 2157. The Alliance enjoys good relations with the Asari, though many privately believe the matriarchs are aristocratic and overcautious. Though humans know better than to unconditionally trust the Salarian, their shared reckless ways make them natural allies against the conservative Turians and Asari. The Krogan have no unified government, but individuals are generally treated as potential criminals, a reputation most Krogan enjoy living down to. The Alliance has no formal contact with the Quarians. Their migrant fleet has not yet passed through any human-settled system. The Batarians are rivals for control of the Skillian Verge. They severed their treaties with the Citadel to prosecute a colonial conflict against the Alliance. Wasn't it more of protest over the Citadel siding with humanity? Officially, there is no war, but neither is there any peace. What about the Hanar, Elcor, and Volus? Yeah, we could just, you know, there's only 17 million Quarians. This would be like, you know, totally just adopt them. You would get like the best technicians and engineers and everything in the galaxy, pretty much, and you'd have like, you know, a friendly alliance for life. Systems Alliance, Geological Survey. As the human race expands its territory and raises the general standard of living, demand for industrial resources continues to grow. Many planets, moons, and asteroids contain a wealth of resources, but many systems have barely been charted, let alone thoroughly surveyed. Unmanned probes are one solution, but they are often lost to space hazards, unforeseen circumstances, or theft by salvagers. In recent years, AGES, the Alliance Geological Service, has offered bounties to private individuals or teams willing to perform mineralogical surveys on the frontier. The survey data is made publicly available to further corporate development. Due to the cost of travel and the dangers of operating on hostile worlds, it is rarely a profitable endeavor. Light metals, metals with low atomic weight, are often used in construction of spacecraft and vehicles. Heavy metals, metals with higher atomic weights, are used to construct equipment components. The platinum group elements are particularly useful. Rare earths. Most useful materials in this category are radioactives or magnets. Gases. Various gases are required to support all known forms of sapient life. Some are commonly used as fuel. Systems Alliance. Military jargon. Ashore. When a ship's crew leaves the vessel, they are ashore, away. Okay, I'm not actually going to read all this. I'm going to skim it, though. Okay, LADAR. Light Amplified Detection and Ranging. An active sensor that bounces lasers off an object to determine its bearing and distance. LADAR has sufficient resolution that the data can be reconstructed into an image. Okay, good enough. Military ranks. I'm not actually going to... Well, okay. Let's see. Alright. Shepherd is a commander. I guess that means a staff commander. I am going to assume that means staff commander. And I think Kaiden is a second lieutenant. Might be a first lieutenant. And Ashley is a gunnery chief. enough. Systems Alliance, N7. The Alliance Military Vocational Code system classifies the career paths of all serving personnel. The MVC consists of one letter and one number. A soldier's MVC indicates proficiency, not rank. The letter notes career path. The number indicates level of experience, as indicated by service record, technical scores, and commendations. All 26 letters are used, and numbers from 1 to 7. N is the letter code for Special Forces personnel. I assume higher number means more proficiency aptitude, meaning that Shepard as an N7 is Special Forces at the highest aptitude. Timeline. 2069. Armstrong Outpost at Shackleton Crater becomes the first human settlement on Luna. It is formally founded on July 24th, the 100th anniversary of the first lunar landing. 2103, Lowell City in Eos Chasma becomes the first human settlement on Mars. 2137, the Eldfell Ashland Energy Corporation demonstrates helium-3 fuel extraction from the atmosphere of Saturn. Why Saturn, not Jupiter? And I guess Saturn is less dense and smaller. 2142, construction of Gagarin Station, Jump Zero, begins beyond the orbit of Pluto. 2148, prospectors discover the Prothean ruins at Promethe Planum on Mars. 2149, translation of Prothean data leads humans to the Charon mass relay. Oh, okay, so there was a mass relay in the solar system. It was just out beyond Charon. Pluto. Systems Alliance founded to coordinate exploration and colonization of extrasolar worlds. 2151. A shipping accident at Singapore International Spaceport exposes downwind communities to containers of dust to form Element Zero. Alliance begins construction of Arcturus Station. 2152. Roughly 30% of the children born in Singapore after Element Zero exposure suffer from cancerous growths. Systems Alliance begins settlement of Earth's first extrasolar colony world, the planet Demeter. 2154, Commander Shepard born. Well, that's not accurate. Commander Shepard was actually born way earlier. She just took a detour in Britannia for a time. 2155, Systems Alliance occupies completed portions of Arcturus Station as a headquarters. 2156, some children of Singapore exhibit minor telekinetic abilities. So, of course, biotics are basically just psionics. They just wanted to give it a different name. 2157. Terrians encounter human explorers. First contact war. Occupation and liberation of the human colony Shang-Chi. 2158. Humans learn potential biotics. An international effort to track Element Zero exposures begins. Roughly 10% of exposed children show some level of biotic ability. 2160. Systems Alliance Parliament formed. 2165. Humans establish embassy on Citadel. 2170. Batarian slavers attack the Alliance colony of Mindor. Which I believe would be another one of the possible origins for Shepard. 2176, Skillian Blitz. Pirates and slavers attacked Elysium, the human capital in the Skillian Verge. And this is, of course, the one that I chose. 2177, Thresher Maws devour the Alliance colony of Akuz. And I think that this is the other one that you could have, where you're the sole survivor. 1 of the other origins rather than the, like, war hero and soul survivor and stuff like that. I can't recall. 2178. In retaliation for the Skillian Blitz, an Alliance fleet wipes out an army of slavers on the moon of Torfin. 2183. Current date. So that makes, Shepard is 29 years old, according to this. Of course, we all know that the Avatar is much older. Planets and locations. Stations. Arcturus Station. Arcturus Station is the gateway to Sol, a 5-kilometer diameter Stanford Taurus-type space station at the trailing Lagrange point of the gas giant Themis. So that's not in Sol. Okay. The Presidium ring of of the Citadel is essentially a Stanford Taurus. We should totally make Island 3 colony, so. Let's see, what was that? Construction on Arcturus Station began in 2151 and concluded in 2162. It was inaugurated in 2156 and has served as the military and political headquarters of the Systems Alliance from the First Contact War until the present. When humanity activated the Charon Mass Relay in 2149, it led to Arcturus, 36 light-years from Sol. Oh, okay. Earth's Sun. Arcturus is the third brightest star seen from Earth. It is an ancient red giant from the generation born before Sol. Its worlds are either gas giants or ice chunks. While some rocky debris exists, the metal content is 25% lower than normal. To build Arcturus Station, metallic asteroids were towed through the mass relays to the construction site. You know, I would think that there would still be plenty of metal there available, but whatever. Many of these asteroids remain near the station, their mined-out areas home to transient populations. Hey, like Luna 2. Except that was a military station, of course. The expense of bringing construction materials into the system was acceptable due to its strategic value. With three primary mass relays in addition to the secondary one to Sol, Arcturus is a major communications and military choke point. The Alliance First Fleet is based in Arcturus, where it can guard the gates to Sol and react to incursions in the three connected clusters. The station also hosts the System Alliance Parliament and the Systems Alliance Military General Headquarters. Its permanent population is approximately 45,000. That is really, really small. Arcturus, I mean, like, a 5-kilometer Stanford Taurus can, I'm pretty sure, can hold a lot more than 45,000 people. But I could be wrong. Arcturus is actually from the Galactic Halo, one of a cluster of 52 stars that are crashing through the disk of the galaxy. In a billion years, Arcturus will be sailing through the depths of extragalactic dark space. Really? Hmm. Of course, by that point, we're actually going to be, I believe we're actually going to be colliding with Andromeda, and we'll be merging into a giant globular galaxy, or ellipsoid galaxy. Ships and vehicles. Starship's crew considerations. Cabins give each individual 10 cubic meters of space. On larger vessels, private rooms are common. As ships get smaller, the number of crew packed into a single wardroom increases. Asari prefer shared spaces even on large vessels, while Krogan territorial instincts make it impossible for them to cohabitate even on the smallest ships. On smaller vessels, hot bunking is the norm. Crew members assigned to different watches share the same bunk. When one gets off duty, he wakes up the person in the bunk. While the crewman is on duty, the first gets his rack time. Spacecraft compartments can be isolated by airtight doors in case of decompression. The cinematic vision of explosive decompression is fiction. Hold compartments either take enough damage that occupants are killed instantly, or leak slowly enough that they are able to reach protective gear. Or, you know, use some sort of gel-like substance to seal the leak. Compartments are equipped with emergency life support apparatus. That was, of course, a reference to the first or second episode of Mobile Suit Gundam. Compartments are equipped with emergency life support apparatus, fireproof plastic bubbles with air bottles. Small when stowed, ELSA comfortably accommodate one individual inflated. Damage control procedure cuts off ventilation to burning compartments. Without oxygen to consume, fires die in seconds. Pardon me. The compartment is repressurized afterwards for crew recovery. Mass effect fields create an artificial gravity plane below the decks, preventing muscle atrophy and bone loss in zero-G. Large vessel... I have never seen zero-G spelled out like that. It is always just zero and then just the letter G. Huh. Large vessels arrange their decks perpendicular to the thrust axis. The highest decks are at the bow, and the lowest at the engines. This allows anti-grav to work with the inertial effects of thrust. Ships that can land arrange their decks laterally, so the crew can move about while the vessel is on the ground. Warships normally turn off their anti-grav systems during combat, reducing the heat generated by the systems and increasing combat endurance. To provide a point of reference for navigating zero-G, floors are painted a different color from the walls and ceiling. Hmm. Starships. Cruisers. Cruiserweight starships are the standard combat unit encountered away from large naval bases, the poor bloody infantry of most fleets. Nimble scouting frigates have neither the punch nor the stamina to stand up to a serious combat, and the mighty dreadnoughts are a strategic resource, carefully hoarded and committed to the most critical battles. Cruisers perform routine independent show-the-flag patrols in settled systems and lead flotillas of frigates in small engagements, such as pirate suppression campaigns. In major fleet engagements, cruiser squadrons support the dreadnought battle line by screening their flanks against enemies attempting to maneuver for a main gun bow shot from their vulnerable broadsides. Alliance cruisers are named after cities of Earth. Of course, if this were Stellaris, you'd just go for nothing but dreadnoughts, aka battleships. The dreadnought is the ultimate arbiter of space warfare. Millions of tons of metal, ceramic, and polymer dedicated to the projection of firepower against an enemy vessel of likability. No sane commander would face a dreadnought with anything less than another dreadnought. A dreadnought's power lies in the length of its main gun. Dreadnoughts range from 800 meters to 1 kilometer long, with a main gun of commensurate length. An 800 meter mass accelerator is capable of accelerating 1 2 kilogram slug to a velocity of 283 kilometers per second every 2 seconds. Each slug has a kinetic energy of 38 kilotons of TNT, 3 times the energy released by the fission weapon that destroyed Hiroshima. When used to bombard planets, some of this kinetic energy is lost due to atmospheric re-entry friction. As a rule of thumb, each Earth atmosphere of air pressure saps approximately 20% of a projectile's impact energy. The Turian fleet presently has 37 dreadnoughts, the Asari 21, the Salarian 16. Humanity has 6, with an additional hull under construction at Arcturus Station. Alliance battleships are named for the mountains of Earth. Everest class. Everest, Fuji, and Elbrus. Kilimanjaro class. Kilimanjaro, Taishan, Shasta, Akongawa. Fighters. Fighters are single-pilot combat small craft. They are lightweight enough that they can be economically fitted with powerful Element Zero cores, making them capable of greater acceleration, sharper maneuvers, and starships. Kinetic barrier shields changed starship battles from short, vicious bloodbaths to extended, indecisive slugging matches. Only the main gun of a dreadnought could punch a mass accelerator slug through the barriers of an opposing dreadnought. This changed with the development of the fighter-launched mass disruptor torpedo, a short-range weapon that can penetrate kinetic barriers to destroy projector assemblies. Starship Guardian defenses, Guardian, would know you, must be overwhelmed through swarm tactics. Fighter groups can take heavy casualties pressing their torpedo attacks home. Once fighter-launched torpedoes have crippled an enemy's barriers, the mass accelerators on frigates and cruisers can make short work of them. Interceptors are a type of fighter optimized to attack other fighters, with no ability to damage starships. Interceptors are used to screen friendly units from incoming fighter attack. Frigates. Frigates are light escort scouting vessels. They have extensive guardian systems to provide anti-fighter screening for capital ships and carry a squad of marines for security and groundside duty. Unlike larger vessels, frigates are able to land on planets. Frigate drive systems allow them to achieve high FTL cruise speeds. They also have proportionally larger thrusters and lighter design mass, allowing them to maneuver more handily. In combat, speed and maneuverability make a frigate immune to the long-range fire of larger vessels. In the time it takes projectiles to reach them, frigates are no longer where they were predicted to be. In fleet combat, frigates are organized into wolfpack flotillas of 4 to 6. Wolfpacks speed through enemy formations, hunting enemy vessels whose kinetic barriers have been taken down by fighter-launched disruptor torpedoes. The wolfpack circles strafes vulnerable targets, using their superior speed and maneuverability to evade return fire. Alliance frigates are named for great battles in human history. Sensors. Light lag prevents sensing in real time at great distances. A ship firing its thrusters at the Charon relay can be easily detected from Earth 5.78 light hours away, but Earth will only see the event 5 hours and 45 minutes after it occurs. Due to the light speed limit, defenders can't see enemies coming until they have already arrived. Because there is FTL travel and communications but no FTL sensors, frigates are crucial for scouting and picket duties. Passive sensors are used for long-range detection, while active sensors obtain short-range, high-quality targeting data. Passive sensors include visual thermographic and radio detectors that watch and listen for objects in space. A powered ship emits a great deal of energy. The heat of the life support systems, the radiation given off by power plants and electrical equipment, the exhaust of the thrusters. Starships stand out plainly against the near absolute zero background of space. Passive sensors can be used during FTL travel, but incoming data is significantly distorted by the effects of the mass effect envelope and Doppler shift. Active sensors are radars and high-resolution LADARs, laser detection and ranging, that emit a ping of energy and listen for return signals. LADARs have a narrower field of view than radar, but LADAR resolution allows images of detected objects to be assembled. Active sensors are useless when a ship is moving at FTL speed. Technology. Biotics, biotic amps. Biotics manipulate mass effect fields using dozens of element zero nodules within their nervous systems that react to electric stimuli from the brain. Amplifiers allow biotics to synchronize the nodules so they can form fields large and strong enough for practical use. Amplifiers can improve a specific discipline or talent. An implant is a surgically embedded interface port into which amps are plugged in. On humans, the implant is usually placed at the base of the skull for convenient access, though the user must be careful to keep it free of contaminants. Implant ports can fit a variety of amps, and there is a growing market for modifications and add-ons. The finest quality implants and amps are manufactured by Asari Artisans, but the Alliance's L3 implants, first deployed in 2170, are a significant step forward. Communications administration. While comm buoys allow rapid transmission, there is a finite amount of bandwidth available. Given that trillions of people may be trying to pass a message through a given buoy at any one time, access to the network is parceled out on priority tiers. The Citadel Council inspectors have absolute priority. If they are using all the bandwidth, everyone else must wait. Individual governments and their militaries enjoy the next highest tier. During wartime, civilian communications can suffer hours or even days of lag. Intelligence agencies study ping time through various systems to predict military buildups. You know, I would think that in a lot of these, you could get rerouting with them going around, but I don't know. Just, you know, with the rapid transmission and, you know, even with the direct line, I would think that a non-direct line would still be near rapid transmission. Let's see. Below the governments and militaries, bandwidth is sold to the highest bidder. Media conglomerates, particularly headline news networks, purchase higher priority to provide their viewers with timely information. Corporations that require timely information and response capability, for example, financial institutions and investment firms, also invest heavily in priority access. The funds acquired through sales of bandwidth are used to maintain and expand the communications infrastructure. While everyone with a computer has guaranteed free and unlimited access to the Galactic Extranet, they are last in line for bandwidth and may have to wait for their requests to be processed. Bandwidth resale corporations use investment capital to purchase blocks of high-priority access made available by paid subscription. Man, it sounds like they need some net neutrality in there. Creds. The standard credit was established by the Citadel's Unified Banking Act as the currency of interstellar trade. The credit has a managed floating exchange rate, calculated in real time by the central bank to maintain the average value of all participating currencies. Some regional currencies are worth more than a credit, and some less. Hard currency can be stolen or counterfeited, so electronic fund transfers are the norm. More importantly, physical transactions cannot be easily tracked, making them ideal for tax evasion or the purchase of illegal goods. When the Alliance joined the Citadel, its various national treasuries were linked into the credit network. A human with a bank account of Mexican pesos, Japanese yen, or Indian rupees can purchase any item priced in credits at fair market value. All economies that participate in the credit network are required to price items in both local currency and credits. Not sure how well that would actually work. Weapons, armor, and equipment. Upgrades. The development of practical manufacturing. Omnitools allows modern militaries a great deal of flexibility in equipment loadouts. A vast number of field modification kits, or upgrades, are available for common equipment such as weapons, armor, omnitools, biotic amps, and even grenades. An upgrade kit typically consists of less than a dozen unique parts and an optical storage disk. When loaded into an Omni-tool, the OSD provides all technical specifications required to manufacture the tools and additional parts necessary to install the upgrade onto another piece of equipment. Assembly is typically modular, and installation can be completed in less than a minute. Since Omni-tools are designed to use common battlefield salvage materials, such as plastics, ceramics, and light metals rendered into semi-molten Omni-gel for quick use, it is quite possible for a trained soldier carrying upgrade kits to customize gear on the battlefield to fit the current tactical situation. And that is...
Combat hard suits use a dual layer system to protect the wearer. The inner layer consists of fabric armor with kinetic padding. Areas that don't need to be flexible, such as the chest or shins, are reinforced with sheets of lightweight ablative ceramic. The outer layer consists of automatically generated kinetic barriers. Objects traveling above a certain speed will trigger the barrier's reflex system and be deflected, provided there is enough energy left in the shield's power cell. Armored hard suits are sealable to protect the wearer from extremes of temperature and atmosphere. Standard equipment includes an onboard mini frame and a communications, navigation, and sensing suite. The mini frame is designed to accept and display data from a weapon's smart targeting system to make it easier to locate and eliminate enemies. Kinetic barriers, more commonly called shields, provide protection against most mass accelerator weapons. Whether on a starship or a soldier's suit of armor, the basic principle remains the same. Kinetic barriers are repulsive mass effect fields projected from tiny emitters. These shields safely deflect small objects traveling at rapid velocities. This affords protection from bullets and other dangerous projectiles, but still allows the user to sit down without knocking away their chair. The shielding afforded by kinetic barriers does not protect against extremes of temperature, toxins, or radiation. Medigel is a common medicinal salve used by paramedics, EMTs, and military personnel.
Picture of Medigel right here.
It combines several useful applications: a local anesthetic, disinfectant, and clotting agent all in one. Once applied, the gel is designed to grip tight to flesh until subjected to a frequency of ultrasound. It is sealable against liquids, most notably blood, as well as contaminants and gases. The gel is a genetically engineered bioplasm created by the CERTA Foundation, a medical technology megacorp based on Earth. Technically, Medigel violates council laws against genetic engineering, but to date, it has proved far too useful to ban.
So, Medigel is literally a brand new thing on the market in galactic space, and humans invented it. Good to know, good to know. But yes, Medigel is people.
All modern infantry weapons, from pistols to assault rifles, use micro-scaled mass accelerator technology. Projectiles consist of tiny metal slugs suspended within a mass-reducing field, accelerated by magnetic force to speeds that inflict kinetic damage. The ammo magazine is a simple block of metal. The gun's internal computer calculates the mass needed to reach the target based on distance, gravity, and atmospheric pressure, then shears off an appropriate-sized slug from the block. A single block can supply thousands of rounds, making ammo a non-issue during any engagement. Top-line weapons also feature smart targeting that allows them to correct for weather and environment. Firing on a target in a howling gale feels the same as it does on a calm day at the practice range. Smart targeting does not mean a bullet will automatically find the mark every time the trigger is pulled. It only makes it easier for the marksman to aim.
Well, how convenient. All right, well, that is about all of the codecs that we have right now, other than, of course, the player tutorials, which I am not actually going to read. Go ahead and mark all as viewed. All right, so that is about it for the codecs that we have so far. As I play through the game on stream, I will periodically read the new entries that we get, you know, as we go, kind of thing. So, I hope you enjoyed these, and tune in for the streams over on Twitch. Thanks a lot.